All right, I guess we'll start. And today we'll start with geometry. So just let me know when you can see the whiteboard. I hope now you all can see the whiteboard, right?
Yes.
Right. So in geometry, today let's see that how many things can we cover. There are many things that we have to cover. We start with triangles, then we move to quadrilaterals, then we move to circles, and then we move to polygons, and then we move to solid geometry, that means the 3D figures. So these are all the things that we have to cover in this topic, but in today's session, I don't know that how much can we cover. So starting with a few very, very basic terms at first, let's say that we often come across some of the terms such as the acute angle, right angle, obtuse angle. So our very first job is to understand what these terms are like. So I'm just saying them out. If there is any problem, just let me know meanwhile, because I'm just trying to go a little faster on these terms, because these are very, very basic of it, right? And you can take the screenshot whenever I am clearing the screen, I will let you know before. So acute angle is any angle which is less than 90 degrees. These are the terms used in the question. So we need to understand what is an acute angle. Now, the next is a right angle. Right angle is when the angle is equal to 90 degrees, then we call it a right angle. The next is obtuse angle. Obtuse angle is a measure when it is greater than 90 degrees and less than 180 degrees. Then there is a term, reflex angle. This is not the term that is used, but sometimes for our discussion during the polygons, we might use this term, but only for our communication. GMAT will not speak about this term at all. So the reflex angle is the angle when the angle is greater than 180 degrees and less than 360 degrees. Then comes straight angle. Straight angle means when theta is equal to 180 degrees. So acute angle, we can draw the figure such as this. Right angle, figure will look like this. Obtuse angle, the figure will look like this. Reflex angle, the figure looks like this. Straight angle, when we have the angle equal to 180 degrees. Now, these are the few terms. Other than that, two more terms are complementary angles and supplementary angles. Now, there can be direct questions based on these terms. So complementary angles and supplementary angles, there should be no confusion at all between these two terms. Complementary angles are the angles which sum up to 90 degrees. So in figure, we can look at them such as this. If this angle is 90 degrees, this angle is A and this angle is B, we call them complementary angles. While supplementary angles are the angles that sum up to 180 degrees. So in terms of figure, we can look at them this way. If this angle is A, this angle is B, then the two angles are called the supplementary angles. Is that understood? So,
yes.
Okay, I'm going to clear the board. If anybody wants to take the screenshot, please do so. Right, I'm not taking any screenshot so far. Unless somebody has some problem with it. All right. So, clearing the whiteboard now. Now that we have discussed these angles, now we will quickly discuss the triangles. Types of triangles. So the triangles can be categorized in two ways. One way is based on the sides. So we call them scalene triangle, isosceles triangle, and equilateral triangle. So a scalene triangle is the one in which all the three sides are different. Isosceles triangle is the one in which at least two sides are equal. When we say at least two sides, that means all three sides also may be equal. However, that particular case of isosceles triangle is called equilateral triangle. So equilateral triangle has all the three sides equal. In case of any triangle, the sum of the angles is equal to 180 degrees. So a scalene triangle has all the three angles of different measure. In any triangle, there is one very basic observation that we can make, and these observations are very critical, that the side opposite to the smallest angle will always be smallest, and side opposite to the largest angle will always be largest. So here, we can see that if I take the scalene triangle ABC, visually we can understand that angle C looks like the smallest angle, right? And the side opposite to that AB will be the smallest one. Similarly, in isosceles triangle, the two sides are equal, and because the sides are equal, therefore the angles opposite to them are also equal. Equilateral triangle, all three sides are equal, therefore all the three angles also are equal. 180 divided into three equal part gives us theta equal to 180 divided by 3 equal to 60 degrees. So in case of an equilateral triangle, every angle is equal to 60 degrees. Right? Can I clear this board now? Is this understood, everyone?
Yes.
Yes.
All right. So now this part is done. And the next categorization of the triangles will be the most important one. So let's quickly see. So I'm clearing the board here. Here I'll join. So once again, I am writing the types of triangles, but now these types are especially important for the questions straight away. So we have three types again here. One is the right angle triangle. Questions can also term them as simply right triangles, right? The second is the acute angled triangle. Third is obtuse angled triangle. Now here, everything that I'm talking about is important. So please make sure that you take a note of everything. Right angle triangle is quite simple to understand. We have been dealing with this right angle triangle. So we understand that when one angle is right angle, then it's a right angle triangle. Right angle means one angle is 90 degrees. In case of any triangle, the two angles are always acute irrespective of what the third angle is. So we are not talking about the two angles, they have to be acute. It's only about the third angle. If the third angle is 90 degrees, it's a right angle triangle. If the third angle is less than 90, then it's an acute angle triangle. And if the third angle is greater than 90, then it's an obtuse angle triangle. In right angle triangle, the sides can be associated with each other using Pythagoras theorem, which says C square is equal to A square plus B square. Now, of course, we understand that C here is the longest side, which we say is the hypotenuse. In case of acute angle triangle as well, we can draw the similar relationship. And that relationship is that C square in this case will be less than A square plus B square. Rather than memorizing, I think we can make it more sensible that if in a right angle triangle, if we reduce this angle, keeping the length of A and B fixed, then what will happen to C is that if this angle is getting shorter, then C will also get slightly shorter because C will get shrinked a little. And in that case, which C square was equal to A square plus B square, will now be less than A square plus B square. So that's what is the relationship in case of an acute angle triangle. And once again, a very important thing here to mention is that C is always the longest side. I'll explain this further. In absence of this fact that C is the longest side, C square is less than A square plus B square does not ensure that it's an acute angle triangle. And similar such relationship can be drawn in case of obtuse angle triangle. Instead of decreasing this angle in right angle, if we were to increase this right angle, then C will be slightly stretched out, will be longer, and therefore we can say that C square will be greater than A square plus B square, where C is the longest side. Now, let me come back to this acute angle triangle again. See, if C square is equal to A square plus B square, automatically it confirms that the triangle is a right angle triangle. If C square is greater than A square plus B square, then it again automatically confirms that the triangle is an obtuse angle triangle. But if C square is less than A square plus B square, it does not automatically ensure that the triangle that we are talking about is an acute angle triangle. Because we might take a particular case in which we have sides 3, 4, 5. And we can understand that 3 square is less than 4 square plus 5 square. So such a relationship does not confirm that it's an acute angle triangle unless we ensure that in this expression, C is the longest side. So here this condition becomes the most important, whereas we have mentioned the same condition in all three cases. But here the condition is completely indispensable. In absence of this given condition that C is the longest side, C square is less than A square plus B square does not ensure that the triangle is an acute angle triangle. Does that make sense to everyone? Right? So please keep that in mind, because the data sufficiency questions especially will be testing you around these kind of facts. So 5 square has to be compared with 3 square plus 4 square, and since they are equal, so basically 3, 4, 5 becomes a confirmed right angle triangle, right? I'm not discussing any question as of now, because in geometry, one of the challenges is that even if you know the concepts, applying those concepts in the questions to answer them is one of the challenge. And with the concepts, when we discuss the question, then application becomes easier. Therefore, I will stop discussing examples when we are discussing the concepts here in the beginning, right? So once we are done with these concepts, then we will discuss the questions at once, and then you will have all the challenges together. You will have to think about all the properties that you know and the application of those properties in the right context. So can I clear this window now, everybody?
Yes.
Okay, fine. So clearing this window, if somebody wants to take the screenshot, please do so right now. Now that we have discussed the triangles, now there are some particular properties of triangles that we want to discuss. And one of the properties is, which is the most important property, is property that ensures that a triangle exists. Property for a triangle to exist, it must satisfy a condition that sum of the two sides is greater than the third side. Now, it's a very famously known property. Almost everybody of us who's not very, very uncomfortable with geometry knows this, that for the triangle to exist, the sum of the two sides should be greater than the third side. So remembering this property is less of a problem, but understanding where to apply this property to check the existence, possible existence of triangle is really an important task. So usually in our school, we learn it this way, that sum of any two sides is greater, should be greater than the third side for the triangle to exist, which is absolutely correct. So for example, if you are given that, please test whether 1, 2, 3, these are the length of three sticks, which have length 1 meter, 2 meters, 3 meters, by joining them end to end, what kind of triangle will be formed? Right triangle, acute angle triangle, obtuse angle triangle, or none of the triangles? Quickly think about it and tell me. If we have these three sticks of length 1, 2, and 3, what kind of triangle can we form? Right triangle, acute angle triangle, obtuse angle triangle? Can't say. Okay. So the answer here is, basically there can't be any triangle. Now, some of us might think that, see, 3 square is greater than 1 square plus 2 square, so probably we will get an obtuse angle triangle. So that's incorrect, because this property tells us something else, but we have to first of all check whether any triangle is possible using these sides or not. So we don't have to test whether 2 plus 3 is greater than 1 and 3 plus 1 is greater than 2. We simply have to test whether 1 plus 2 is greater than 3 or not. So there is a small amendment that I make in this property, and which is, I simply say that sum of two shorter sides must be greater than the longest side for the triangle to exist. Now by doing so, what I have done is I have just excluded these two tests. I have to just test only one particular case in which the sum of the two shorter sides is greater than third side or not. We just have to test it, right? So we only see that sum of the two shorter sides should be greater than the third longest side for the triangle to exist. Otherwise the triangle won't exist. Now the next thing is, we also have to learn that where does this property come from. So we have to understand the derivation of it. And but before that, about the application of this property, please make sure that you take a note of it. Whenever the question discusses the calculation of third side, we always have to test whether third side is acceptable as per this property or not. Whenever the question expects us to calculate the perimeter of the triangle, the perimeter of any figure is basically the outer boundary. So in case of triangle, the perimeter is the sum of the three sides of the triangle. Whenever the question prompts us to calculate any one of these two things, you always have to test whether the side calculated is acceptable or not as per this property. That's the only comment I can make which can help you understand where do we have to apply this property. Otherwise, the question will never prompt you that please check this property. Now we go to the derivation of this property. So where exactly does it come from? So I am going to take a particular case of sides 3, 4, 5. In our school, we used to have an exercise of drawing a triangle using the compass and scale. So I'm going to replicate the same process here. So in our school, we used to learn it this way. When we have to draw the triangle using the compass and scale, we will just draw a side, a line of longest length. So in this case, it is 5. Then we take an arc of radius maybe 3, one of these remaining two, and we make an arc like this. And then we take an arc of the other side, which in this case is 4, and we make an arc of side 4 like this. Now we will have this particular case that when the endpoints are joined with the point of intersection, we get a triangle of side 3, 4, and 5. Right? Because the arc here was 3, so this distance will be 3. The radius here was 4, so this distance will be 4, and then we have this length side of 5 already. Now I'll explain that why are we discussing all this thing. If we were to draw the triangle of side 3, 2, 5, for instance, what will happen? We draw the side of 5 here. We will once again make an arc of side 3, and we will make an arc of radius 2 from the other end. But do you realize because 3 plus 2 is exactly equal to 5, so the point of intersection will be on the line itself, and there won't be any possible case of triangle. So some of the two sides cannot be even equal to the third side. Some of the two has to be essentially greater than the third side for the triangle to exist. So that's the derivation. Now how to apply this derivation? We will discuss on the next page. But before I remove this page, I just want to mention one more thing that we also learned that there is a property that difference of two sides should be less than the third side. I am skipping that property intentionally because that is simply the second representation of the same thing. If a plus b is greater than c, then obviously c minus b will be less than a. So you don't have to remember these two properties in isolation. The other property is actually the replication of the first property only. Right? So I just want to clear this board and want to explain that where is this derivation important. Can I clear this thing here?
Yeah, sir.
All right, so clearing the board. But the last thing, Vikram, last thing I just mentioned that the difference of two sides is less than third side is not a new property anymore. It's exactly the same thing. So we don't have to learn this property again. If you know that some of the two sides is greater than the third side, then automatically the difference of the two sides has to be the less than third side. That's all I mentioned, right? So we don't have to remember this property at all. The first property itself is self-sufficient. Now clearing the board here. The next part. Now the application of this property. Let's understand, because this application is especially useful for the questions which will be of 700 difficulty level. What happens is sometimes the GMAT will give us a question in which they will provide us only with the two sides and not the third side. They will say that the two sides of a triangle are 6 and 8, where the third side is unknown. Which of the following could be the areas? That means now we have to figure out that what are the possible areas of a triangle which has these two sides 6 and 8, while the third side can have any possible length. Right? So let me just write it again here. So the question is that what are possible areas of triangle with sides 6 and 8 while third side is unknown. So that's a typical case that we need to be ready for. So now we are going to use that property. This is one type of question. Anytime when you come across a question in which some input is missing and some inputs are given, if you have to think about the possible cases of triangle, then at least this property and this derivation gives you a ground to make multiple figures. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make multiple figures of triangles which have two sides of length 6 and 8. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to draw a side of length 8 first. Let's assume that this is side of length 8. And now, because I have to draw the second side of length 6, so I'm just making a circle, an arc of radius 6. Because that's what we do according to that derivation. Now, if any triangle has to have the two sides 6 and 8, then the third point must be on this arc only. Only then we can get a triangle, right? So let me make the possible cases here. For example, the one possible case of triangle would be this. This is one in which this length is 6 and the bottom length is 8. Now we can make the second such case. This is the second possible triangle with one side 6 and one side 8. I hope now everybody can follow that every triangle that we are drawing here, which has a third vertex on the circumference of this blue circle, will have two sides of length 6 and 8, while we don't know the third side. The third side could be anything. So I am just drawing several cases for us to imagine. So one thing is, it helps us imagine multiple cases of the two given inputs. Now, the next case could be this triangle. The next case could be, okay, let's call it case number 5. Now let's call another case number 6. Because here I'm going to ask you a question. And here let's draw case number 7. The question that I'm going to ask is that which of the following cases will have the maximum area and which of these following cases will have the minimum area? If we know that the area of a triangle is calculated by the property of half of base multiplied by height. Now, which of these cases will have the maximum area? Quickly tell me that thing first. So Apol says that all the triangles will have equal area. Okay, Sathak says fifth case. The shop is out. Let me bring him in. Okay. Which one of these cases will have the maximum area? Okay, now let's quickly understand the area is given by half of base into height. While the base is fixed for all of them as 8, we only have to focus on the length of height. The figure in which the height is maximum, the area will be maximum, and the figure in which the height is minimum, the area will be minimum. If we were to draw the height, then the height in case number 1 will be the perpendicular drop from the third vertex on base. So this length will be the height. In the second case, the height will be the second case. In the third case, the height will be this particular distance. In the fourth case, the height will be this particular distance. So far now we can understand the height has been showing an increasing pattern. That means case number 1 will definitely have less height than case number 2, which will definitely have less height than case number 3, which will have less height than case number 4. And the case number 5 seems to have the greatest height when I have tried to draw the case number 5 perpendicular sides case. And then case number 6 seems to have slightly lesser height again than case number 5, which means what we understand is that the maximum height has been obtained in the case number 5. Here we have the maximum height. And if you look at the figure, then visually we can say that the least height is in case number 1. So this again confirms that whenever the height is maximum for the common base, the area is maximum. And whenever the height is least, the area will be the least. Which means from here we can draw an inference that for any two given sides, the area of the triangle will be maximum when the given sides are perpendicular to each other. Right? I repeat that once again. For any two given sides, the area is maximum when given two sides, that means 6 and 8 in this case, are perpendicular to each other. So this is one of the properties that we have just derived. And this will give us the range of areas. That means the maximum area that we are getting in this case is equal to half of 8 multiplied by 6, which means the maximum area is 24. So what we can say, with only two given sides, the area can range from 0 to 24. Right? So this is one thing that I wanted you to learn to derive. Because such questions, when pop up, we have to understand that with only two given sides, we can at least find out the range of possible areas, which means if there is any value given which is greater than 24, then certainly it cannot be the area of the triangle with two sides 6 and 8. Does that make sense to everyone? So now when you have the limited inputs, you have to think the possible cases of areas such as this. Right? So this is one case. Now, let us quickly discuss just last few things about this triangles. And I think this meeting may end in 10 minutes. So I have to share with you the invite of another meeting that we might start after this meeting ends. So all of you can just keep it handy. Once this call gets over, you can once again join in the meeting using these credentials. All right, coming back to it.
Sir, excuse me, I don't have the option to see the chats. I cannot see anything in chats. Even this option is not visible.
Achha. Ayush, you can't see the chat?
No, I cannot.
I don't know why would that happen. Let me see. Ayush. Oh, but I can send you this thing privately. Did you get some message?
No, nothing has reached me.
Okay. If that is the case, I will have to send it to you, this thing, on WhatsApp. Right?
Okay. I'll
send you this detail on WhatsApp anyway. Okay. Meanwhile, I'm just clearing the board. I hope this property is understood to everyone. Right? Clearing the board. If you want to take the screenshot, please do so now. Now, the next thing here is to understand some special cases of right angle triangles. We call them special right triangles because these are the triangles which are most frequently used in GMAT. These are the only cases which will be used in GMAT when the question discusses any right triangle. So, let me quickly mention them. The first one of such cases is the Pythagorean triplet. That is the Pythagorean triplet of sides 3, 4, and 5. This is one most frequently used right triangle in GMAT. We need to understand that this will come up again and again. Ayush? Can you see the chats now?
Yes, I can see it now. If connected from home, phone, then it's working.
Achha. Anyway, I have sent you that invite on your WhatsApp as well. Okay.
Thanks.
So, starting with this special right angle triangles, the first one of these cases is the triangle with the sides 3, 4, 5. That's the most frequently used. We can see the multiples of them as well. That means the second multiple of 3, 4, 5 will be 6, 8, 10. The third multiple of them will be 9, 12, 15, or 12, 16, 20, or 15, 20, 25, or for instance, we can also see somewhere 75, 100, 125. These are all the Pythagorean triplet that have been seen in the official questions of GMAT. They keep coming up again and again. Now, the need to know these is because even if we know the Pythagoras theorem, we need to just acknowledge somewhere, if it's not given that it's a right triangle, that it is a right triangle. For example, in some questions, they might mention that there is a triangle which has sides 12, 9, and 15. And if you don't acknowledge that it's basically a right angle triangle, which is being formed using the sides 9, 12, 15, then we might not be able to answer the question at all, or at least not that effectively. Right? So it's important that we know these Pythagorean triplet, and we must have eye to figure out that these numbers are forming a right triangle. Now, there is a side effect as well, looking at it. What happens is now when the students are told that these are the usual Pythagorean triplets which are used in GMAT, then they start assuming a couple of things. For example, if we say that there is a right triangle which has two sides, 6 and 8, then quickly they start thinking that, oh, if the two sides are 6 and 8, then the third side has to be 10. And that is an incorrect fact. The reason is they have assumed that the right angle is being formed between the sides 6 and 8. Now you see, if the sides 6 and 8 are at 90 degrees, then yes, we are right. Third side has to be 10. But what if the 6 and 8 are not forming the right angle and 8 is the hypotenuse? In that case, the third side would be square root of 28, right? So these are several things which are tested, especially in data sufficiency questions. Now, what I said is the wrong assumption is that we assumed that the right angle is being formed between the two given sides. You should always question these facts. Is the right angle given between the two sides? So the two sides and the triangle being right angle does not ensure that these Pythagorean triplets are going to be used, right? However, yes, these things should click to you quickly when you see a right angle triangle, right? This is the first case. The second case is the triangle with the angles 30 degrees, 60 degrees, 90 degrees. This is the second most frequently used right triangle in GMAT. When the sides are 30, 60, 90, then they have the fixed ratio of their sides, which is 1:√3:2. Now, how do we know which side should we assign as 1, which side root 3, and which side 2? This is the ratio. That means if the angles are 30, 60, 90, then we already have observed one thing during the scalene triangles discussion, that the side opposite to the smallest angle is the smallest, and the side opposite to the largest angle has to be the largest. Here, the smallest angle is 30 degrees, and the smallest of these three parts is 1. That means opposite to the 30 degrees, we call the side as X. Then the largest is 2, the largest angle is 90. So the side opposite to 90 will be 2X, and so the side opposite to 60 will be √3X. Please remember this ratio. This ratio will come up again and again. You will see the application of this repetitively. So we need to remember this. And by remembering this ratio, we completely bypass the trigonometry, right? We don't have to use the trigonometry anywhere in the questions of GMAT. So these are two specific right triangles. The third one is the triangle with the sides 5, 12, 13. This is a peculiar right triangle, especially keeping in mind the number 13. This number 13, whenever you see in geometry questions of GMAT, will probably use in great majority cases the Pythagorean triplet 5, 12, 13. So whenever you see a number like 13, and if the question belongs to the unit geometry, you should be able to think about this Pythagorean triplet, else you will be inefficient in answering that question. And the fourth case of specific right angle triangles that is used very frequently in GMAT is the triangle with angles 45, 45, 90 degrees. This is a case which now we can comfortably understand because two angles are same, so the two sides must be same. It's an isosceles right triangle in which the two sides, if they are taken as 1, then the third side will be square root of 2. This is the ratio of the sides. That means we write the sides in the ratio 1, 1, root 2 this way. If the two sides are x, which are at 90 degrees of each other, then the third side will be x root 2. And this is another case which is very frequently used, but since it's very easy to remember, therefore we don't put so much emphasis on it. Is that clear? This is very important part of right triangles. In 99% cases, any right triangle that we are going to come across has to be one of these four cases. So please take a note of this. Now I'm going to clear the screen. So if you want to take this screenshot, please do so now. Right? Clearing the board now. All right. I think we'll just stop this meeting and then start the new one, right? Before I discuss the next thing. So I'm closing this meeting here, and then we'll start the next one in a minute.